Hi, this is Srinivas Lakyam. Today we are going to see AWS demo. Do you know what is AWS? AWS is cloud provider, right? AWS is cloud provider. Cloud provider. So what is cloud provider? What is cloud? So before going to start cloud, let's see what is actual problem in real world. See, in any software development, we have three teams. One, development team and testing team. Testing team and next administration team. So this administration team provides what? Resources, right? Administration team provides resources. Okay, development team develops code and testing team tests the code, and to develop code and to deploy that code and to test that code, we need servers. So this administration team prepares resources. Okay, in this administration team, again we have three teams: hardware team and networking team and operating system team. Operating systems team. Okay, again this administration team, we have three: hardware team, operating system team, networking team. What hardware team do? Hardware team arranges complete hardware, and operating system team install operating systems and install what? Softwares. And if development team or testing team gets any problems, they'll resolve that problems. Networking team enables networking, so we can access this system or set of systems through the network anywhere, right? So this network team creates that networking environment. Okay, assume initially we set up this system with this configuration. So initially we have a server with 5 GB RAM, and we have four core processor and 500 GB hard disk or storage. This is our server configuration. So development team writing code and deploying into this system, and testing team using this system for test environment purpose. So after writing set of instructions, this system is not sufficient to process this code, because many processes are running inside this. So this 5 GB not sufficient, and these 4 core processors are not sufficient. This 500 GB storage is not sufficient to store the data. So to resolve this problem, what this team do? This team increases the RAM size with, instead of 5 GB RAM, they increased 16 GB. Assume they increased 16 GB. Instead of 4 processors, they increased 18 or 8 core processors. 8 core processors, and instead of 500 GB, they increased 1 TB hard disk. Okay, they increased these resources, and again they this development team deploying the code. But this 16 GB RAM, this 8-core processor, this 1 TB also not sufficient for processing this code or running this code in this server. Again, we increase what? Again, we increase this team, hardware team increases resources. Increases resources to, instead of 16 GB to, they increased 32 GB. Instead of 8-core processors, they increased 16 core processors. Okay, instead of 1 TB, they increased 2 TB in this system. After some time, this application is using less memory. After optimization or something, this development code using less resources. Just 5 GB is enough to run that application. Just these 4 core processors are enough to run that application. This 500 GB is enough to store this development code. So can we decrease this resource size to again back to 5 GB and 4-core processor and 500 GB storage? No, right? Once we buy, whether you can use or you cannot use, whether we use, we cannot use what? We have to use. There is no other option. Once we buy, these resources are fixed. Right? So we cannot reduce these resources. So the problem with this, we can increase resources, we cannot decrease. If you decrease, these resources are wasted. Okay? So to resolve this problem, if you go to cloud, assume this is my cloud environment. Cloud. In this, I set up one system, one server. So I rent one server. So this is my server machine. So this is my server machine. Initially, I rent this server with this resources 5 GB. Initially, I rent 5 GB RAM, and initially this system has 4 core processors, and 500 GB hard disk, 500 GB storage. So initially I rent these resources. Okay, my development team using this system, and connecting this system through the network, deploying application code into this server system. Okay, then this development team keep on developing application and deploying this application into this system. Assume this 5 GB RAM is not sufficient. Assume this 4-core processors are not able to process our code. Assume this 500 GB storage is not sufficient. Then we can increase these resources dynamically. Okay, we can increase these resources. Instead of 5 GB, what we can do? We can increase to 16 GB. Assume we increased 12 GB and we increased this one to 8 core processors, and we increased this one to 1 TB hard disk. Assume this 1 TB, these resources also not sufficient, then we can increase. We can also increase this one. Instead of 12 GB, I can increase 32 GB. Instead of 8 core, I can increase 16 core. Instead of 1 TB, I can increase this to 2 TB. So dynamically we can increase these sizes. Assume after some time, this much resource is not required to process latest code. Then we can reduce back to 5 GB, 4 core and 500 GB. We can reduce our sizes, whatever the size we buy, we rent, we can reduce these sizes back to 12 GB or 5 GB. It is possible in cloud environment. We are not purchasing any resources in cloud. We are just renting hardware. We are renting resources. Okay? So to take instances in cloud, there is one service called EC2. So we use EC2 service in AWS to rent these instances. Okay, we'll see this EC2 instance service. Okay, in cloud we have two major concepts: horizontal scalability or vertical scalability. Vertical scalability and horizontal scalability. In cloud or physical environment, we can do horizontal scalability and physical vertical scalability. Do you know what is vertical scalability? In a single system, if you increase RAM size or processor size or hard disk size, initially we have 5 GB, assume initially we have 5 GB RAM and 4 core processors and 500 GB hard disk. If you increase these resources size, instead of 5 GB, if you increase 12 GB RAM, if you increase instead of 4 core processors, if you increase 8 core processors, instead of 500 GB, if you increase 1 TB, if these resources are not sufficient, again you can increase 12 TB to 32 GB, and 8 core processors to, you can increase 16 core processors. Instead of 1 TB to, you can increase 2 TB. But there is a limitation in vertical scalability. In vertical scalability, we can extend up to some extent. We can extend these resources up to some extent. We can find maximum of 128 GB RAM, maximum of 32 core, maximum of 2 TB hard disk. You cannot find more than these size resources. In this case, we cannot extend vertical scalability. So to resolve this problem, we have horizontal scalability. In horizontal scalability, like these systems, we can buy and we can place multiple. So we can take multiple machines. cloud supports both. In AWS cloud, you can implement vertical scalability, you can implement horizontal scalability. But in vertical scalability, we can implement, we have a limitation. Okay? In vertical scalability, we have limitations. But in horizontal scalability, there is no limitations. Okay? Yep. So AWS services, we'll see list of AWS services. First, as part of this AWS services, we'll see EC2 service. What is this EC2? EC2 stands for Elastic Compute Cloud. Elastic Compute Cloud. So through this EC2 instance, EC2, we can rent RAM, we can rent CPU, we can rent storage. Storage we can rent from EBS. EBS stands for Elastic Block Store. Elastic Block Store. Elastic Block Store. This provides what? Storage. Okay? As part of EC2, we can rent RAM, we can rent CPU, and we can rent IP address. IP. To access this instance through the network, we need one IP. And through EBS, we get what? Storage system. Okay? So AWS has predefined templates, called AMI. AMI. AMI stands for Amazon Machine Instance. Amazon Machine Instance. So by using this service, you can get different operating systems. So there are multiple predefined configured operating systems are available. Okay, you can get operating system by taking this AMI. Next, EC2 gives us two services. One is RAM and another one is CPU. These three we get as part of what? EC2. EC2. And storage we get from EBS. Okay? These RAM and CPUs are RAM and CPU is shared tenancy. We get as part of shared tenancy, or we can get dedicated tenancy. But this is storage is permanent. So once this storage is assigned to our instance, this is permanent. So once it is allocated, all application data is going to store into where? In this storage. So storage is permanent, but we can get RAM and CPU and IP addresses as shared tenancy and dedicated tenancy. If we are taking this RAM, CPU, IP address in shared tenancy, once we stop our instance, whatever the RAM, CPU, IP address allocated to our instance is released automatically, then assigned to other systems. If you take RAM, CPU, IP address from shared tenancy, once we stop instance, automatically these resources are released from our instance and assigned to other instance. Once we start our instance, some other RAM and CPU and IP address assigned dynamically to our instance. Okay, if it is a dedicated tenancy, RAM, CPU and IP addresses are permanent. Those resources cannot allocate to any other instances. Those are permanent to our instance. But compared to shared tenancy, these dedicated tenancy, they will charge more. Okay. In these systems, after setting this EC2 instance, what we will do? In EC2 instance, developers access this systems, right? Developers from our different branches can access this system throughout the net. Throughout the net, they can access this system. What they will do? They will deploy applications. They will deploy applications, right? So they will deploy applications. They will install in this server, they will install required software, and in that software, they will deploy code. Okay? So complete code stores into where? In this system. In this storage. If you want to take this storage backup, and if you want to maintain that backup in permanent location and safety location, AWS provides one special service called S3 bucket. There is one storage concept, S3 can store any type of data. It can store any type of data. Any kind of data. So mainly we use S3 for taking backups and storing backups into S3. If you lost any storage data, we can restore from S3 bucket to our instance. Okay, we will see this S3 bucket, how to create S3 bucket and how to create directories in S3 bucket, how can we store backup data into S3, how can we access data from S3 bucket to our EC3 instances. Okay, so this is very important S3 concept, and S3 is unlimited storage. This S3 can store unlimited data, unlimited storage. There is no limitation. You can store any size of data in this S3 bucket. There is no limit. There is no limit. This S3 service is a global service in Amazon. S3 is a global service in Amazon. Global service in AWS. It means this S3 service span across all regions. There is no limitation. It can span across all regions. You can store any size of data into S3 bucket. There is no limitation in S3 buckets. That's why you can store backup, any size backup into S3 bucket. Okay? And next, after this EC2, after this EBS, after this S3, we will see very important concept in AWS. VPS. We'll see very important concept. Sorry, not VPS, VPC. VPC stands for Virtual Private Network, Private Cloud. Virtual Private Cloud. So by using this VPC, we create our own network. Let's see one simple scenario. Assume this is our network. This is our cloud system, and in this we have multiple. We take in multiple systems. There are two systems, server systems. These two are server systems. Application server 1 and application server 2. So in these systems we deployed our application. So we deployed application 1. So we deployed app 1. In both systems we have app 1. Okay, so for load balancing, we have one special concept in AWS called ELB. We'll discuss this ELB later. Assume we configured ELB. What is ELB? We'll see. Okay, so any request comes from through the network, any request from client, anywhere in the world. First request comes to this ELB, and ELB identifies load on each server. And since based on load on server, it diverts request to servers. Okay, so these two servers are public access. So I created public network. But there are some other servers. Like database cluster. So this is DB cluster. And there are some cluster like big data cluster. This big data cluster has multiple machines. So this is big data cluster. So I don't want to give access, public access to these big data cluster and database cluster. I want to give access only for this application servers. I don't want to give public access to this one. So I will create my own private network. So how do we create this private network? Means we use VPC. In AWS we use VPC concept to create private network. In this private network I will write rules. In that rules I will allow only this network, only these machines to access this one. I don't allow any other machines to access this private network. Did you got it right? So in this private network, what I will do, I will allow only these two application servers can access these systems. Any other systems cannot access this this private network. I can set rules to this private network so that only these application servers can access. How do we set up this complete network? Means there is one special concept in AWS called virtual private cloud or virtual private network. By using this, we can create our own private network. We can create our own public network, and we can give access only this private public network to access this private network. Any other systems cannot access anywhere. Okay, so we can set to this feature, we can implement to this networking by using what? VPC. Okay, coming to ELB. ELB stands for Elastic Load Balancer. ELB stands for Elastic Load Balancer. Elastic Load Balancer or Load Balancing. Elastic Load Balancing. What is this Elastic Load Balancing means? This ELB receives a request and it identifies these servers. We configure these two servers with ELB. Then this ELB, Elastic Load Balancer, identifies load on each server. If this server is having heavy load, then ELB transfer request to this server. Assume if this server is having heavy load, then this ELB transfer to this server. So we have two servers, application server 1, application server 2. Assume these two servers having heavy load. We want one more server dynamically. So there is one special concept called auto scaling. What this auto scaling is, in auto scaling, we configure our application server instance. What this auto scaling is do, when these two servers having heavy load, what this will do, it will create one more server dynamically, with the same features of this application server. So in this application server, we have whatever applications we installed in this system, equivalent to this mission, it will create one more mission. Then it will attach to ELB. Dynamically it will attach to ELB. Then ELB identifies load on these two servers and divert new request to this third server. If load is reduced, in auto scaling we can configure like that, if heavy load on these two servers, create one. If load is reduced on these servers, remove this newly created. We can configure that features in auto scaling. If load is less in these two servers, automatically newly created server is removed from this public network. If heavy load is available, if heavy load on these two servers, again it will create one more new server with all features of these two servers and attach it to ELB. This feature is called what? Auto scaling. Okay, we can enable auto scaling. If you enable auto scaling, whatever the setup, whatever the features we set up in, configured in auto scaling, with the same features it will create one new instance and attach it to ELB. Okay, and there is one more important feature, CloudWatch. This is very important feature. What is this CloudWatch? When you configure CloudWatch to your EC2 instance, if you configure CloudWatch to EC2 instance, it monitors instance. it monitors instance. There are two features. There are two features. Basic monitoring and detailed monitoring. In basic monitoring, for every 5 minutes it will monitor our instances. For every 5 minutes it monitors instances. In detailed monitoring, for every 1 minute it monitors instances. So what it monitors? It monitors what is input. It monitors what is CPU utilization. What is input output or read write speed, and it will monitor bandwidth. So in CloudWatch, it monitors only these three features. It monitors what is the CPU utilization, what is the read write speed in disk, and what is bandwidth of your system. How much bandwidth is consuming? So if you attach CloudWatch to your instance, it will do what? These two operations. What is basic monitoring and detailed monitoring? Basic monitoring is free. So you can attach CloudWatch with basic monitoring. For every minute, it gives these three features. If you attach CloudWatch with detailed monitoring, it will give these features for every minute. But this is priced. This is not free. Okay? Like this, we are going to see multiple services. And there is one more service called RDS service. RDS stands for Relational Database Service. Relational Database Service. As part of RDS, it is providing services to Amazon Aurora and MySQL and it provides MariaDB and Postgres and SQL Server. And it also providing services to Oracle. So if you consume this, or if you take this RDS service, instead of setting instance, and in that instance, if instead of installing database services manually, you can take this RDS service. Like assume you have taken this MySQL RDS service. It will provide additional features, like it will provide different logs, and it will maintain different logs about your database, and it will give different monitoring features. So you will get additional features when you take this RDS service. Okay? And there is one more service called Route 53. What is this Route 53 service? How do we identify systems? How can we access systems through the network? By IP address. By using IP address. our hostname, right? By using IP address, our hostname, we can access system through the network. Assume I want to access this system. So I consumed one system. Assume this is my system. How can we access this system? By using IP address. Or by using hostname. Right? By using IP address or by using hostname, we can access this system. Assume I want to access this system with hostname. Assume this system hostname is XYZ. I want to access this system or this hostname is sinotech.com. I want to access this one. So how can we access this system through the network means there is one service called DNS service. So this DNS service, what this DNS service do is it convert IP address to hostname and hostname to IP address. If you pass IP address, it will convert IP address to hostname. If you pass hostname, it will convert hostname to IP address. This is a hostname and IP address resolver. So in our AWS, Route 53 acts like DNS service. So in this Route 53, we configure IP address and hostname. So this Route 53 resolves this naming IP address to hostname and hostname to IP address. Okay, like this we are going to see 15 services in our AWS class. We see what is AWS and we'll see very important one, important concept IAM. We'll see this by using this IAM concept, we can create users, we can assign roles, we can set permissions. Okay, we'll see this one in depth in our coming classes. Okay, we will see VPC in depth and we create our own network, and in that we create our own network to give internet access to these private machines. We do what some operations in VPC. We'll see this in depth in our VPC class. Okay, we will see EC2 instance related. We will see how to take a backup of EC2 instance and how to create our own Amazon instance and how to take volumes backup in this EC2 classes. Okay, we will discuss briefly about lambda expressions. What is lambda? Next we will discuss in depth about different concepts like ELB, auto scaling, S3. So like this we will discuss around 15 concepts in our AWS course. Okay, you got it right? We are going to discuss all these concepts. You can find this complete course details from sinotech.com. Okay, thank you for watching this video. Please subscribe our channel and please give your valuable comments to videos. Thank you.